most important part of the blockchain is that the transactions and our balance is there. It's immutable and it goes only in one direction. I'm sure that all of you are well aware that blockchain is so popular because it's kind of proof that the transactions and the balance are there and we can work on them. Where we have transactions and balance? I'm not sure that all of you see this diagram, but on top is our member, so he can go through portal and deal shaker. These are the places where you can interact and exchange coins inside the community. After you go to these places, you can send coins or buy some goods and services there. And these make a transaction in our API. This is a REST transaction that is sent synchronously to the blockchain. And it returns the response that says, okay, this amount is sent to the smart contract. We are waiting for the feedback from the blockchain to validate the transactions. Therefore, when you send some amount of coins or buy some goods in DealShaker, first step is to block the amount. That means that the transaction is not validated by the blockchain yet. And when blockchain validated transactions, we are changing the status as completed. This is just a short description what is the transactions to make it clear how we see the transactions and what are the expectations for there. This is just transfer of fungible amount of tokens from one wallet, one identity wallet, to another identity wallet. Just simple. When we are talking about tokens in a blockchain environment, there are two types of tokens, fungible and non-fungible. Non-fungible tokens are popular in the last year or two because they are so-called NFTs. We are working with fungible tokens because we are currency, we are cryptocurrency, and it's important to know that all tokens are equal, they can be freely transferred between members, and they don't have a specific identity behind them. They're just amounts to be transferred from one member to another. Different networks provide different management options for the tokens and their holders. In our network, we have strictly defined only three actions that can be executed on the smart contract. You can transfer coins, you can discard them, and you can manage the balance of the people. Manage of the balance is kept for only master wallet can manage the balance, and it requires some manual interaction with the identity. And additional level of security is added there by the special multi-sign contract defined only for the master wallet. This is how complicated is the process. There are different steps in the transactions that make the transaction start the queue because we can handle millions of transactions simultaneously. We can handle them by receiving these transactions and order them in the queue. We made a huge effort to allow this volume of transactions possible because we believe that the network is strong, it's growing, and the transactions needs will increase drastically in the coming months. Even when we start the new deal shaker, huge amount of volumes will come there. So here, the transaction queue is what will handle all the requests. Then it go to transaction management and the blockchain validate them one by one. Yeah.
Questions after or before?
Right now, it's a good time.
Transaction queue. Speed.
It depends. We have...
1 minute. How many?
It's 5 seconds per block maximum.
Which block could be?
5 seconds, and the transaction is up to 30.
So
we can increase the number of transactions per block if this is necessary and we need more volumes. Right now, this number is a good balance between cost and performance. Two important things. Right now, our blockchain is set up as a private blockchain. But in the future, all these identity and transactions can be moved to a public network. If we want to go public and go on the mainnet, we can transfer all of your identities there to start using public wallets and public identities to manage your network. About consensus algorithm. Let's say that there are different kinds of encryption, how the miners validate the blocks and the transactions. All of them have some pros and cons. In our blockchain, we are using proof of authority as an algorithm because right now it's the best algorithm in Ethereum space. Next year will come the next level in the consensus algorithm, proof of stake. And we are already working on this improvement. When Ethereum releases the proof of stake algorithm, we'll adopt it in our blockchain network. As I told you, the block time is up to 5 seconds. It can be faster if there is a small amount of transaction, but it's between 3 and 5 seconds per block. Our smart contract is based on ERC-20. This is the most popular, let's say, standard for tokens. It comes with specific methods and specific actions to be executed there. So we are following these standards and we are adding a few more improvements there to handle better our scalability requirements. What are the scalability requirements? You know that we have a blockchain network, but we have systems on multiple locations distributed globally. And we have gateways in different regions in the world, South Asia, Europe, and South America. So we are collecting the traffic from these points. We are handling them through different payment API server, and we are transferring them to the blockchain. This means that the global coverage is properly distributed and you can send the transactions from any location in the world at the same time. Two things are important in this diagram. This is the architecture of our payment solution. The most important part are blockchain gateway node and the transaction lock. Transaction lock keep the sequence of all transactions in a readable form. This allows us to show you the transactions, the history, and the sender and receiver in your wallet in the portal. And the other part of the blockchain shows the transactions through Block Explorer. This allows us to interact between the database and the blockchain at the same time and not stressing the blockchain with too much requests just to view the transactions. Last but not least, we are managing the blockchain identities as a custodian wallet. This means that the key that is used to prove your identity is kept on the database level. It's in your identity there. When you validate yourself with username and profile, we are loading the key in your identity and it's not required to use your key there to validate transactions. When we go public, you will have control over the key. You receive your key and you manage all the transactions through this key. But for now, to make it more easier to handle and to, let's say, not allow you to lose your key, we are handling it automatically in the system. I believe that all of you are well aware of this screen. So this is my wallet. When you go in the latest transactions and view your full history there, You can see more details about the transactions. Important part of the history here is your hashtag. It appears here when the transaction is completed and it's validated by the blockchain. So if the transaction is still pending, as blocked here, there is no hashtag. But when the transaction is completed, you can see the validation hash of the transactions. And let me try to show you more details. Of course, if you go to the Block Explorer, in the latest mined transactions, you can find all the transactions with their hashes. There is a 15 minutes delay on this screen, so we are not showing immediately the transactions here. We are showing them on a group. After 15 minutes are gone, your transactions will appear in the Block Explorer. We are using this approach in order to prevent a huge amount of traffic to the blockchain, because this is calling every time blockchain to show the last amount of transactions. And what is when the transaction is executed, I will go back to my wallet. And I will connect directly to the blockchain. I'm copying this hashtag of the transaction to check what is there in the blockchain about this transaction. This is the Block Explorer and the API that is connected to the blockchain. I'm sending the request to get the details about this transaction. And you can see that this transaction is part of this block. This is the block number and this is the block hash. Again, it's proof of authority validated. You have the sender and the receiver here, ID of the receiver and ID of the sender. You have the input and the output that is if you remember this complicated diagram with multiple states of the transaction process, this is the input that is sent to the queue, and queue is handling it. You have how much gas is consumed to handle this transaction, and where is the status value? Okay, this is the value of the previous and the next transactions converted into hashtag. If I get another transaction, let's say that I'm copying the hashtag of the other transaction, new block hashtag that is related to this transaction, where it comes from, and again, receiver identity and sender identity. It's critical to know that we are not showing identities of the sender in the receiver in the Block Explorer, because we want to keep this information private. If we show your identity in the Block Explorer, this means that anybody can check all your transactions and movement from your wallet to another wallet. This is sensitive information that you can see in your profile here. Here in my transaction history. But we are keeping this private only for you. And in our private blockchain, it's private information.